This is Ankit from MolBiolect. So today I'm going to show that how the entry of COVID-19 in your body creates the different kind of symptoms you are going to see. We are actually seeing in different kind of websites and many doctors are posting it. So how we can see the symptoms? What causes the symptoms to arise? So first of all, in general, this is the COVID-19. Okay, this COVID-19, when it enters the cell, lung cells basically, this binds to the ACE2 receptors, RNA is formed, ribosomes, it produces plus different kind of viral proteins. So this RDRP is nothing but RNA-dependent replication proteins, that RNA-dependent RNA polymerases actually. So this RDRP, it produces the RNAs, and this RNAs along with the viral protein over here, this viral protein, they combine and they are ejected as the new virus particles. Now, we have our ACE2 receptors over here. We have the ribosomes. This is not actually along with ACE2. There are many receptors. Okay, like TMPRR5, many receptors, like protease kind of receptors are there. So this entire thing, that entry into lungs, binding to ACE2, going through ribosome, assembly of viral proteins over here, viral protein RNAs along together, and ejecting, is basically the life cycle of the virus. This takes place in vivo in type 2 pneumocytes. So I've already written. But for any in vitro assay, we use different kind of cells. So CALU2 cells, those are nothing but immortalized lung cells. So how they are immortalized? Basically, they are lung cancer cells, nothing else. Now, this after entry into lungs is life cycle part I have dealt with. Coming to the other part, we have this COVID-19 over here. Entry into alveoli. When it enters the alveoli, the alveolar macrophages are there, along with many neutrophils are also there. Neutrophils are there because alveolar neutrophils are also present over there. It is basically going inside from the blood vessels surrounding the alveoli. Now, this can produce ROS, reactive oxygen species, and the protease. There are ciliated cells in alveoli, like this one, type 2 pneumocyte. Those are ciliated cells, okay. So they are, as they are cleaved by proteases, this signal is sent to the alveolar macrophage. On sensing this neutrophil and these pneumocyte generated signals, what it does is that it produces IL-1, IL-6 and TNF-alpha along with this C-reactive protein I have marked over here. So this IL-1, IL-6, TNF-alpha, these all passes through the blood surrounding the alveoli. So pointing over here, this is pointer is not working. This is the blood passing through the blood alveoli. Okay, basically in this step, this IL-1, IL-6 and IL-1, TH1, TH17 is basically cytokine storm is happening inside your alveoli. So as the cytokine storm is happening, more and more fluid buildup is happening in your alveoli. Thus, it can cause the first symptom, which I'm going to come a little later. So this cytokine storm, as I've shown, as it forms, and as these signals IL-1, IL-6 and TNF-alpha passes through the blood surrounding and reaches the hypothalamus in the brain, it causes fever. So the first symptom, fever, is generated. Next thing is, whenever this blood surrounding the alveoli is, basically what happens is that the oxygen concentration of the blood, it reduces. The partial pressure of oxygen in the blood reduces. As this happens, it creates hypoxia. The second symptom, diagnostic symptom, is there now, the hypoxia. As the partial pressure reduces, some chemoreception part takes place. I'm not going to deal with this with this video. So this chemoreception takes place, and this chemoreception causes SNS, sympathetic nervous system, to be activated. As it activates, it produces two things, or causes two things rather. First is the increased heart rate. The heart rate is increased. Sometimes it may cause variable heart rhythmic episodes, okay, so it can be variable. The heart rhythm may vary, maybe sometimes high, maybe sometimes low. It can cause that. Along with that, we have increased respiration rate, because your alveolis are already filling up with the body fluids, the cellular fluids, and more cells are destroyed. The type 2 pneumocytes are destroyed. So all those cytocellular, all those cytosol contents are coming inside the cell, inside the alveoli, and it's causing to be filled with fluids, and it causing respiration rate to increase. This is the thing. Now, this IL-1, IL-6 and TNF-alpha, when it passes, it also causes vasodilation, increase in permeability. which causes this, actually this vasodilation increase in permeability I'm marking over here is blinking of red light, red pointer. So this actually what causes is that this vasodilation causes more and more neutrophil to come. So this neutrophil, it comes more and more in the blood, enters the alveoli, fluid, the buildup of fluid is even more increased because of this. Now, so this is one part of the thing. The next part, I have given a star mark over here. So what happens is that this vasodilation increase in permeability of membrane may also cause septic shock. Okay, so this septic shock can produce, cannot produce actually, may cause the volume of blood volume to be lowered down. The blood volume gets lowered and the blood pressure is also lowered. So this septic shock creates lowering of blood volume, lowering of blood pressure, which can lead to perfusion. And this perfusion can actually lead to multiple system failure. This is the second thing which happens. And the difficulty in breathing part, I have already shown that may cause fluid buildup, alveolar edema. So this fluid buildup is called alveolar edema, where the alveoli is really gorged up with the fluid. And this increased work of breathing due to fluid accumulation happens and causing difficulty in breathing. So these are some very essential symptoms of the COVID-19 infection. First, we have fever, then we have difficulty in breathing, it's a slight difficulty in breathing, then we have got something known as irregularity in the heartbeat, sometimes it may increase, sometimes it may decrease, then we have respiration rate increase because of this fluid buildup and everything, we have got cytokine storm in our body, and when this vasodilation happens, it may cause septic shock, resulting in lowering of the blood volume and blood pressure, leading to perfusion and then multiple system failure. Now, the question is, suppose someone is already infected with the virus, they recovered either completely or maybe at the stage of recovery. So can we use their blood serum for creating antibodies for very critically sick patients? The answer is yes. There are studies which support this statement. Although, because it is not a clarified theory, I'm not going to present that how it is done. But this theory about the using of the plasma from the patients already suffered from the COVID-19, it may contain antibodies because we have got cytokine storm over here. Okay, Th1 and Th17 induced cytokine storm. So maybe there are antibodies present in the patient's serum which can be used, which can be purified and which can be checked for any kind of reactions and all histocompatibility complex and everything we should check. And after purifying those antibodies, we may check that whether it can be used as vaccinations or it can be used to treat critically ill patients right now. But this is, there is some screenings going on. Okay, so I'm not going to talk about it in much details. So it's basically convalescent plasma theory, basically, where blood plasma theory, where treatment actually. So where you take the patient's serum and you purify it, remove any kind of unwanted things, the antibodies are taken, concentrated, and is injected into the critically ill patients. So it's basically the part of the convalescent blood plasma theory. And as we have already known that in our body we have got some immune defenses, and whenever a virus particle or something enters, it may happen. But one thing is that many problems arise because this virus strain, when it's entering, there is no prevention. Like our own immune system is not preventing the virus from replicating inside the type 2 pneumocyte, or you may say the lung cells. Why this happens? So actually there's a factor, which it actually stops. It's basically interferons. It's interferons. Whenever the virus enters a cell, it basically deactivates some interferons in our body. I'm not going to tell the exact name, that is IF1, interferon 1 RT. So interferon 1, it stops that, basically makes it non-performable and helping it to actually invade the host and replicate inside them. This is how the main thing of entry of COVID-19 into the cells, the all kind of symptoms generated over here. Although I must say that I am not completely talking about the convalescent blood plasma treatment, and also I'm not talking completely about the interferon because I'm reserving this for my next videos. But apart from all this, this is how these symptoms are generated. And these are the most common symptoms in COVID-19 cases. Thank you. Please like, share, comment, and do subscribe to my channel for learning more. I try to be updated every few days or every few hours about the COVID-19 cases and how it enters. And also, I should like to thank you all for helping me reach 100 subs right now. I wish I would get more motivation from you guys. So thanks for making 100 subs in my channel. Thank you. And bye.